Welcome students, this video is about NMAT data structure. In this video, we will understand what this question type is all about, how to practice them, what can be various logics, what should be the strategy while attempting or leaving these questions during an NMAT exam. Well, NMAT has been a pretty standardized exam over last 5 years. It is an exam having 120 questions to be attempted in 120 minutes. There are 3 sections. Our section, reasoning, would have 40 questions to be attempted in 38 minutes. Out of these 40 questions, generally we have seen one or two sets of this question type data structure. One set is of 4 questions. That means over the period of time last 4-5 years among various windows, we have seen either 4 or 8 questions of data structure. Data structure is also commonly known as input-output based questions among the student communities. These two sets or one sets, whatever we got in various windows, were either easy or manageable and they were worth attempting, or in some windows we saw them very difficult to crack and hence worth leaving. That means understanding whether this bunch of 4 questions or 4 plus 4, 8 questions are worth attempting or not is the key during the reasoning section, which demands you to move at a rate of 1 question per minute. Let's understand the typical structure of this question type, that is input-output based question or data structure based question. Well, you would have an input. That input is the first line in which you are given some numbers, or probably you are given some meaningful or meaningless words. They are put in a random order. Then you would have a step 1 after that. It would follow some other steps as well. The step 1 might have the same numbers rearranged, which follow the certain logic that you need to find. Or if you had some words in the input, those words might be rearranged due to some logic. Here, the idea is to find the logic or the rationale that drives the movement of words or the change in the appearance of the words or the numbers. The logics or the rationale that drive the movement from input to step 1, step 1 to step 2, and so on, can be related to maths, maths logic, some operations, or it can be related to some order that the question tries to arrange the data in, or it can be something very creative that is understandable ultimately if you can crack the logic. Let's understand some variety of data structure one by one using some examples. Here is the first example. There are some numbers given in the input. Numbers are 85, 16, 36, 4, 19, 97, 63, and 9. Then the set further gives us details about step 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. The set has declared step 5 as the last step. Our objective is to find the logic behind the movement of the numbers. Fortunately, we can see that the numbers are not changing. They are just changing their places. So what can be a particular logic? A quick observation of step 5, that is the last step for our set, says that numbers are arranged in descending order. But then the same task could have been accomplished in a single step. That means there is an ultimate objective to arrange all the numbers in descending order. At the same time, there are stepwise objectives as well. For example, an objective of a step is to bring one number at the right place. Here in the step 1, ideally 97 should have been at the top, but 85 was at the front. So step 1 had a personal objective of bringing 97 at its right place and nothing else. Step 2 on the other end focuses on the next number. Fortunately, 85 has come at its place on its own, so it can focus on the next deserving number, that is 63, and so on. So our set follows a descending order logic. So it's a basic logic of maths that it is following. Cracking the same logic was the first thing expected from a test taker. There was an ultimate logic, there was a stepwise objective as well. A student should understand that using any particular input and following this logic, one can expect any step from the test taker. So after giving this set, one should expect that the questions following the set would give a different set of numbers as input, and step 2 or step 4 or step 5 can be expected from a student. For this set, there is one worth noticing fact, that is you can find any future step using a given step. So, a step 4 can be identified using step 1, but then you cannot go back. I mean, for a given step 5, you might have multiple step 4. So, that is our first example. Now, second example. I wish to take an example based on words now. Here the input is does, a, the, there, would, soon, may, good. These are random words put here as a form of input. Step 1 has the same words but arranged in a different order. Same is the story for step 2, step 3, 4, 5, 6 and 7. Again, a very good hint is to look at the last step, because probably the set achieved something in the last step. We can observe that all the words are arranged in the opposite or reverse order. Good was the last word, now good is the first word. Similarly, thus was the first word, it has become the last word now. So, ultimate logic is to arrange all the words in the reverse order. But then, intermediate steps have a particular logic. The logic is all the words are shifting towards right. And that means the last word available, for example, it's good in input, it falls down and goes back to the only blank space available, that is first step. Now, in step 2, again all the words move towards their right. So, the last word of step 1, that is may, it falls and goes to the only blank spot, that is the second spot in the step. So, may goes to the second step. Similarly, between step 2 and 3, soon falls down and goes to the only blank space of step 3, that is third space. In this manner, ultimately all the words get arranged in the reverse order with respect to what they were initially. Here in this set, it is possible to find any step using any other step. It's even possible to go backwards as well, because every particular word has identified place for a future step. Example number 3. This is again a maths based set. The input is 49, 31, 17, 30, 18, 97, 25 and 80. The numbers are changing their places. Ultimately in step 5, they are arranged in a particular order. A quick observation reveals that they are not following a typical order like ascending order or descending order. Neither the number of digits matter, because they all are 2-digit numbers. It was up to the student to find a possible logic behind these numbers. Well, the real logic behind this set is to arrange the numbers based on the number of factors the number has. For example, see carefully. First number 17 is a prime number. It has exactly 2 factors. 31, the next number in the last step, also has 2 factors only, because it's a prime number as well. Similarly for 97. Yes, we had 3 prime numbers. If we have same number of factors, then probably the set wants us to arrange the number in ascending order. But then 25 and 49 are perfect square numbers. They are perfect square of prime numbers, so each of them has 3 factors. 25 is a smaller number, so 25 comes first, 49 comes later. Similarly, 18, 30 and 80, they are composite numbers. 18 has 6 factors, 30 has 8 factors and 80 has 10 factors. So, that justifies their positioning. It is indeed little debatable that how quickly a student can identify this logic during a test paper. And that is what makes this variety in exam complicated. Here in this set, it's visible that we are arranging available numbers using certain logic. So, the data given in form of number matters to us, unlike the previous set in which the words didn't matter us, their positioning mattered. So, it's possible to find any future step using a previous step or input, but we cannot go back from a particular step, because there can be multiple outputs. So, let's understand how to practice this part of NMAT. Well, first thing is collect some material that has decent collection, decent variety of input output based questions. Second step is put some time limit against each and every set so that you are not just focusing on solving the set, but you also wish to finish the set in a certain time. For example, just to start with, you might like to keep a time limit of probably 5 to 7 minutes. In actual exam, you will have to finish a particular set within 4 minutes because it has 4 questions. So, not just practicing, but practicing with a time limit is the key. I believe it is needless to say that we don't need to find the answer exactly or literally. We do have options. NMAT has 5 options below each and every question. So, when you understand the logic and you wish to use it to find a certain step, you don't need to find it completely. Just try understanding, try utilizing the options. Options would save a lot of time at times. Especially, yes, you can probably solve a set in 6 minutes without any help, but with help of options, you may reduce it to 4 minutes, and that is what matters in actual NMAT paper. Moreover, over and above a typical testing of data structure sets, I recommend that you subscribe to some mock NMATs, because some of the difficulty levels of data structure are on higher side. You might need to leave that set aside in a real testing time of 38 minutes and 40 questions. So whether to attempt a set or not is a tricky thing, and that can be only experienced by a student by mock NMATs. Finally, the strategy during the actual paper should be simple. You start attempting the reasoning section as per the order. Once you come across a data structure based question, you should be keeping an eye on the timer. Give yourself 1 good minute. If within 1 minute you are able to understand the logic behind the movements, then solve the set. Suppose you couldn't solve it or couldn't understand it completely in the first minute, you understood probably partially. Look at the option. If you feel that the options are good enough for you to crack 3 questions or 2 questions, finish them. When should you not attempt a data structure set? Well, obviously, if you couldn't crack the logic in first 1 minute, then probably it's the right time to leave the set aside. It's a very typical and recommended thing if the logic is really difficult. Second scenario is little weird. In first minute, you actually could understand the logic, but you also understood the fact that each and every question would demand certain solving. It will probably slow you down. So even after cracking the logic, you might like to keep probably all the 4 questions aside, or probably you might keep a couple of questions aside which were probably very lengthy. So in short, do practice data structure, that is input output based questions, before you go for actual NMAT. Do attempt some mock NMAT papers. During the paper, you take a wise decision of attempting a set or not based on the advices that I have given in the video. All the best.